Hey friends, you see this question asked all the time on Ableton forums and social media groups where people ask, what's your mastering chain, or what order of effects should I use? And there are all these people who are completely convinced that there's a specific order that effects go in, or that there's a best mastering chain out there. Commonly, especially beginners who are using Ableton Live will go into their audio effects rack tab and drop in these mixing and mastering racks into their master bus. The usual response as to why they would do this is because they feel that it makes their mix sound better. What I'd like to do with this video is break down why this is a mistake, and why this formulaic way of thinking about mastering and mixing causes bad mixes, and why I really believe these mixing and mastering chains are really doing a disservice to music producers. So in order to understand why these chains can wreck your mixes, let's first talk about linearity versus non-linearity. Most of these racks contain what are known as gain-dependent or non-linear effects. These effects include compressors, limiters, saturators, and so on. These devices react differently to signals depending upon how loud the signal is going in. That's what's meant by non-linearity. Let's take a listen to these two different mixes sent through one of these mixing and mastering racks and compare the two. Okay, so I'm going to choose Punchy Dance Master, all right? And as we can see, this is a rack, and there's some controls here, but if I click on the Show Hide Devices, we can see what's inside of it, all right? And so what I've done is I've got two mixes here, okay? I've got this first mix and this second mix, and they're completely identical. The only difference between them is that one of them has an extra 6 dB of gain applied to it, okay? So let's listen to the first mix. That sounds pretty good. Let's go ahead and listen to the second mix. Now, obviously, what I'm hearing is that the second mix is kind of squashy. It's got distortion in it. There's some things going on. Now, if you felt like the second mix sounded better, potentially the reason that you felt like the second mix sounded better is probably because it's louder. Okay, there is more decibels going into this master rack. So what I want you to do is listen again. Let's listen to these mixes with their RMS levels matched. What that means is that the perceived volume is the same. Let's listen to both of these mixes. So here's the first one. And here's the second one. And remember, this is using the exact same rack. I'm running both of these mixes through this rack. As you can see, with 6 more decibels running into this, that's wrecking the mix. It's just absolutely destroying it. It sounds horrible. So the first thing to know is that these devices are going to have a drastically different effect on your music depending upon how loud your mix is. Each one of these effects needs to be optimized to have the best effect on your music. And no, as much as the internet wants you to believe that there's a magic mix volume level that you should use for these effects to work best, such as always mix to negative 23, negative 18, negative 6, whatever, that's just not true either. All nonlinear effects have what are known as thresholds and gain settings. Each one needs to be adjusted to suit incoming signals. Now, there's definitely an optimal range that will make it easier to use these effects, and definitely an ideal ratio between peak level, which is the dark green meter, and the RMS level, which is the bright green. But this is something that changes depending upon the sound you're going for, the genre you're working with, the signal material itself, and the loudness target that you're going for, and even more than that. So that's volume. Now let's talk about EQ. With EQ, you'll have the same effect on your music regardless of the incoming gain. As in, if you boost 5K by 2 dB, the EQ will always boost 5K by 2 dB, regardless of how much incoming gain there is. So you might think now, okay, well cool, at least using the EQ part of these mastering racks is a great idea. But let's take a listen to two different mixes that are relatively similar sounding and feed them through the same effect rack, okay? I've got these two mixes, and what I'm gonna do is I'm actually going to turn off the Punchy Dance Master, okay? And we're gonna listen to mix one and mix two. All right, so here's mix one. Okay, and here's mix two. So these mixes sound a little bit different, but functionally they're pretty much the same, right? So let's go ahead and listen to the difference when I turn on this Punchy Dance Master rack to these two mixes. So let's listen to maybe mix two first. Now that sort of works. Let's go ahead and listen to mix one. Now, you can clearly hear that the bass is just, it's just too much. There's too much low end in this mix, and it's causing the mix to sound wumpy, and it's almost to the degree where it's distorting, okay? That's because this mix, mix one, tends to be heavier in what appears to be 60, 50 hertz, but mix two seems more balanced in that area. So when I solo this mix, watch. Then I listen to this mix. So as you can tell, this EQ setting doesn't make sense for two different mixes. So even with a linear effect such as EQ, you can plainly see that these static preset settings or preset racks make zero sense to use on a mix. But this is so common that mastering suites such as Ozone have preset mastering chains. I think this is a cultural phenomenon due to people using preset synth patches, which is totally fine. A synth preset isn't going to wreck a mix. But unfortunately, you can't use the same preset philosophy on a mix. You can create great mixes with just Ableton Live native devices or with Ozone. But hopefully by now you can see why you shouldn't use preset chains to treat a mix. Now some folks are going to say that I mix into a limiter so I don't blow my speakers, or so that I can simulate what my mix will sound like when it's mastered. This, along with mixing into other processors such as saturation and bus compressors, is a technique known as top-down mixing. This can actually be really helpful if you know what you're doing and you have a good amount of experience, but this can also be a giant pitfall mistake if you're not careful. Let me show you why. Let's listen again to two mixes that are running through a limiter with the same settings, okay? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to disable this punchy Dance Master. But instead, I'm going to grab a common limiter that a lot of people use, and this is my favorite limiter. It's incredible. The FabFilter Pro L2. So I'm just gonna get this punchy Dance Master crap out of here, and we're gonna use this Pro L2. So now, I'm gonna set my ceiling, just like in Ableton's limiter, you can set your ceiling to whatever. I'm just gonna put it at a safe -5, all right? So what I'm gonna do is I'm going to boost my gain by a modest 6 dB, okay? So let's listen to mix one. That's what mix one sounds like. Let's take a listen to mix two. Now, mix one is a little bit darker, right? There's a little bit more low end. But when you listen to these two mixes together, when I listen to mix one and I listen to mix two, functionally they're pretty much the same, right? You have pretty much the same level, and you have pretty much the same kind of overall sound that you've got going on, okay? So in this case, this limiter is making these mixes that sound pretty different sound relatively the same, okay? Let's listen to these mixes without the limiter. So this is, again, this is mix one. This is mix two. We can easily hear that these are very different mixes. They have a very different mix quality. But when I have the limiter on and I listen to mix one, and then I listen to mix two, notice how they sound similar. They sound a lot more similar than when we didn't have the limiter on. Okay, let's try something else. So now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna turn this limiter up to 10 dB. Let's actually really crush this mix with this limiter, okay? I'm gonna turn it up to 10 dB, all right? And we're gonna listen to mix two first, all right? So here's mix two. Now let's listen to mix one. Do you hear the distortion in the kick? Do you hear the distortion in the snare drum? Do you hear the pumping and breathing that's occurring? Okay, now, this is demonstrating a couple things. So the first thing that we demonstrated was that if you have a limiter on your master bus and you don't know what you're doing, you don't know what the limiter is doing, you're not really sure what's going on, what it's going to do is it's going to mask the problems that are in your mix, okay? It's going to take away your ability to hear what could potentially be wrong with your mix. There's a process I like to refer to as preparing your mix for a limiter, okay? And what that process means is that you're working within each track, and then you're working within each bus, getting the mix ready to be limited. You can optimize audio for a limiter to treat it better, okay? That's what the second example is showing. Now that I have this limiter jacked all the way up to plus 10 dB, when I play mix one through it, it's awful. Right? There's a lot of distortion. But when I listen to mix two, it's optimized for the limiter, so it sounds a lot better, okay? So let's take this one step further. I have my own audio effect rack that I've tailored toward Mix 2, okay? And this Mix 2 has now this audio effects rack, and I'm going to put it before my limiter, of course, and these are effects that I've designed specifically for this song, all right? Now, when I play them with this Mix 2, it's going to make this Mix 2 sound even better. There's going to be a benefit to that, okay? So what I'll do, we still have the limiter running. I'll A-B this mix. So here's with this, without this effects rack on. There's still a little bit of distortion in there. It's still a little crushed, and I'm doing this on purpose. I'm actually pushing volume into this limiter a little more than I normally would because I really want you to hear what's going on. Now, when I turn on this processing, we have an even better sound, okay? I've got a multiband dynamics that's taking my low end and we're kind of compressing a little bit of the low end and trying to homogenize the subs. I've got a glue compressor that's kind of adding sustain and glue to the entire mix. And then I've got an EQ on mid-side mode that is enhancing some of the stereo quality and optimizing some of the EQ to be limited, okay? So that's what's going on here. Now, when I play the first mix through this processing chain, listen to what happens. It's even worse than it was when I was just running it raw into the limiter, okay? I really hope that I'm driving this home. The essential takeaway from at least what you've learned thus far is that if you don't know what it does, what the device does, don't mix into it. It's a much better policy to learn how to use the tools that you have and build an effects chain that is uniquely tailored to each mix. Now, I know that to the beginners, this sounds tedious and time-consuming. Slapping a preset mastering chain or copying someone else's settings seems like a reasonable shortcut, but their mixes are different than yours. You gotta understand that you're coming up in a time when mixes are getting better and better and better. The tools are getting more and more and more accurate. If you don't take the time to learn these things, your mixes are never going to have the professional polished edge that other mixes will have, even if you aren't the one mastering them. Even the best mastering engineers in the world can't save a bad mix. Now, you can learn how to use these devices and how to mix and master properly with just YouTube. All the information you'd ever need to learn is in that search bar. However, all this information isn't organized at all, and you have to know what your mix needs in order to know what to search for. And there's an equal amount of bad misinformation, as you've already seen, that can slow you down. The biggest hurdle of all is not having mentorship to answer these questions. So I've created online courses for learning Ableton Live that aim to solve all those issues. If you want to learn more about that, I've created a free 1-hour webinar that you can take right now that will seriously upgrade your mixes and actually help you understand why. So check that out in this link or in the description and in the comments. Now you can learn from a lot of amazing producers and channels on YouTube. But if you like my teaching style and you find my videos easy to follow and understand, I encourage you to check out that webinar and consider enrolling in my Ableton courses. My main mission is to upgrade your skills quickly and efficiently while maximizing your understanding of what you're actually doing. That's so important. Of course, I'm always going to be making free Ableton content on this channel, so if you're into that sort of thing, make sure you subscribe. Anyway, thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed this. I hope this is helpful, and I'll see you next time.